Good afternoon. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for this invitation. I'm a member of the proctology unit of the Gemelli Hospital in Rome, and I will talk to you about the techno-free procedure for the treatment of anal fistula. As you know, we have several technological procedures, but now there is a trend toward the no technological treatment of anal fistula, so there is a sort of back to the past. And so I will talk to you the flap, the lift, and the fistulotomy with or without sphincter reconstruction. Concerning the endorectal advancement flap, this is the oldest and classical procedure for the complex fistulas. This is the original paper by Elting published on the Annals of Surgery more than one century ago. The technique is the same, so it is important to identify the internal anal opening, and then this is the creation of the endorectal flap, with mucosa, submucosa, and usually also some fibers of the muscle, of the internal anal sphincter. It is important to avoid an excessive tension and also to provide a good blood supply. The internal opening is closed, and then the flap is sutured distal to the dentate line, this is important, with a series of resorbable sutures. Concerning the results, we have several literature, several papers on this topic. We know that the success rate is about 60-80% also in the long-term follow-up. Clearly, the success rate in Crohn's disease is lower, but there are several papers also trying to identify the potential factor associated to a better outcome. For example, it is clear that smoking is a risk factor for failure, not only for the flap, but also in every case of fistula surgery. The adoption of biologicals such as infliximab in Crohn's disease could be helpful. And so there is also a study by Netherlands showing that a flap performed after the therapy by biological is better. There are contrasting results concerning the characteristics of the patients and also concerning the technique, because one of the hot topics concerning the flap is the adoption of a seton prior to the definitive surgery. There is only a retrospective study showing no differences between the adoption or non-adoption of the seton prior to the flap, but I think that actually no study reported a lower success rate after the seton drainage, and so I think that is a good option to put a seton before the treatment by flap. The addition of something to the flap is not a good idea. Several studies showed that glues, lift, or sponge are not useful. But we also we should discuss about the risk of continence after the flap, because the endorectal flap is not a totally sphincter-sparing technique. The risk of continence impairment is about 10-30%, and so we should discuss with the patient about this. What are the reasons? The risk of minor fecal incontinence, soiling or gas incontinence, is probably due to the section of the internal anal sphincter during the creation of the flap, because I think that it is quite impossible to create a vital flap without a small incision of the internal anal sphincter. So my conclusion are that it is an option for the treatment of complex fistula, is an old, classical and better evaluated. The success rate is moderate. There are no clear risk factors for failure, but it is important to say that it is not a minimal invasive technique, because there is still a risk of minor incontinence. The lift. The ligation of the intersphincteric fistula tract is now the hot operation. It's really important to know this procedure. This has been described 10 years ago, but probably more than 20 years ago. And this is the technique of Royan Sakulu in Thailand. The technique it is important to identify the fistula tract into the intersphincteric place. And this is, it is useful the use of a probe and of a seton. But this is the experience coming from Thailand. This is an impressive series of 251 patients with more than 5 years follow-up, no continence impairment, and the success rate is about 90%. But the literature is different because, for example, this is a systematic review showing that there are several variations concerning the technique, lift plus something, lift plus plug, lift plus interposition of mesh, and also the success rate is different. It could vary from 47% to 95%, and we don't know why it is. But as I said, something is changing, the guidelines are changing, and so probably now we are going back to the past. For example, these are the guidelines coming from the American Society of Colorectal Surgeons. As you can see, in 2011, the fibrin-glued injection and the anal fistula plug were recommended, were an option, but now in the United States, glues and plugs are considered ineffective, and this is really important. The endorectal plug was an option in 2011, and now is still recommended with a strong recommendation, 1B. But the new kid on the block is the lift. In 2011, there was no recommendation because the literature was poor, but today the lift is an option, again, with a strong recommendation. So I think that lift is a fashionable treatment because, for example, this is the final program of the last meeting of the American Society of Colorectal Surgeons held a few days ago in Cleveland. They discussed about the sphincter-sparing option for fistula and anno. It is really impressive to see that they discussed only about lift and flap, no word concerning other technological procedure. But it is not orosis for the lift. The fistula surgery is never a bed orosis. And so there are several contrasting results in the literature. For example, this is the FIAT trial, which has been published 1 month ago by the NHS in the UK. They randomized 300 patients with a high transsphincteric fistula. 152 patients underwent plug placement, and the other half an alternative surgical techniques. Among the alternative surgical technique, there is also the lift. The success rate is about 50% in all cases, but what I want to underscore is that looking at the fistula healing rate per received procedure, the success rate of the lift is only 42% after 12 months of follow-up. And so this is very different from the original publication. Again, this is a study coming from the United States. You know this study. There is an increased adoption of the lift, but the healing rate in this study is only 47%. And this study comes from the group of Avkarian, which is a father of fistula surgery. So it is an odd surgical treatment. The success rate probably is 50-70% also in the long-term follow-up. There are several technical variations. I don't know what is the ideal patient for a lift, because I think that an anterior straight fistula in women is different from a posterior large curvilinear fistula in a man. Probably the success rate is different. Finally, the fistulotomy. Potentially is the simplest procedure, potentially is the most effective with a success rate universally over 90%, but is also potentially the most dangerous because the risk of continence impairment could vary from 10 to 70%. So we suggest to add in every case a sphincter reconstruction, immediate sphincter reconstruction after the fistulotomy. This is not a new technique. This is probably what you do every day in your operating room. After fistulotomy, we perform an accurate debridement of the tract, and then a primary sphincter reconstruction is performed by a series of interrupted resorbable sutures. Sorry. This is a tip for the technique. We suggest to perform an end-to-end sphincteroplasty with a 5/8 to 0 resorbable suture. But I think that is important to include in the suture not only the internal anal sphincter and then the external anal sphincter, but also the fistula tract. The results concerning the success rate are really good, 93% in this systematic review, but there is also a risk of continence impairment, which is 12%, which is different from the 30, the 50% coming from the simple fistulotomy. But it is also important to see that the risk of continence impairment is mainly due to the post-defecation soiling or gas incontinence. The risk of major fecal incontinence is very low. This is our long-term experience. This paper has been submitted for publication, is currently under review. 200 patients with at least 12 months of follow-up in all cases, about 100 patients with the complex fistulas. These are the results. 5 years of follow-up, an healing rate of 93%, a risk continence impairment of 12-13%, but mainly consisting of defecation soiling. The patient satisfaction rate was evaluated by a enumerating rating scale. It was 9.3. We also performed a Nunez multivariate analysis to identify factors associated to this outcome. No factors were associated to healing because the fistulotomy is good in every kind of patients, concerning the success, obviously. The risk of continence impairment is higher, obviously, in complex fistulas, but this is important, in my opinion, because the only factor which reduced the satisfaction of the patient is the postoperative onset of continence impairment. So my conclusion are that the fistulotomy offers the highest chance of healing universally in every part of the world. The risk of continence impairment, mainly minor, exists, so it should be discussed with the patients. But I think also that an immediate sphincter reconstruction reduces the risk of continence impairment and so should be added in every case, also for simple fistulas. Finally, I would invite you to this international conference that we are going to organize in Rome for the next years on fecal incontinence and obstructed defecation. Thanks.